Championship Wrestling, bringing you great wrestling action sanctioned by the NWA, the National Wrestling Alliance.
World Championship Wrestling, Tony Schiavone along with Jim Ross and David Crockett. We are at the Arena of St. Louis, Missouri, one of the hotbeds of the NWA in our first event as Freebird Michael Hayes and gorgeous Jimmy Garvin against James Bradley and Alan Martin and Jim Ross. Just the beginning of a great 2 hours here on the Superstation.
Indeed, you're right, Tony. In these next 2 hours, the fans are going to see right here on the Superstation for the World Six-Man Tag Team Championship. Ivan Koloff, the Warlord, and the Barbarian will challenge the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, and the Road Warriors. Plus, Ronnie Garvin takes on Arn Anderson. We'll be talking about the big Buckeye Stamping Finals on Sunday, January 24th, in the Nassau Coliseum. It's going to be a dynamite 2 hours of action. The top stars in wrestling all here. And we're seeing the leading contenders for the NWA World Tag Team Championship. Michael Hayes is in there now with Alan Martin. Hayes and Garvin really making a name for themselves nationwide in their quest for the championship.
There you see pressure down at ringside as Alan Martin up against this man, Freebird Michael Hayes. This has been more or less like a warm-up for these two. They have really been running right through Bradley and Martin, two guys with much less experience. As the fans here at St. Louis watch on, the NWA goes coast to coast here at the hotbed. A lot of great matches have been held right in this building of the St. Louis Arena. A lot of great titles have changed hands.
This is a great wrestling city and has been for years. The National Wrestling Alliance has always been the dominant force as far as professional wrestling is concerned in this great athletic city.
Right here, we're going to Jimmy Garvin, right on the chest of Alan Martin. Martin now against the ropes. Garvin shoots him to the other side. And a high backdrop. Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin, you can see Precious feeling good about that one. You're right. Top contenders to the World Tag Team title, but Ric Flair has to also be concerned about the threat that Michael PSA holds to his World Heavyweight belt.
Hayes right now currently the number one contender for the NWA World Heavyweight Championship. Right now it's all tag team action. Hayes has been tagged in, double elbow. Alan Martin in trouble here on World Championship Wrestling here on the Superstation.
Right now Hayes, form of a suplex right there, back right down to the mat.
A little action in his effort to pin Alan Martin. In any event, Martin got a shoulder up. As you said, Tony, this is not another match that Hayes and Garvin wanted. They want to wrestle Arn Anderson and Tully Blanchard for the NWA World Tag Team Championship. And if you fans, whoever it may be, get the opportunity to be at the card when that match happens, don't miss it. That is a war.
To the back of the neck once again. And now Alan Martin continues his assault. Maybe getting the best of Michael P.S. Hayes right here. But now Marshall, set up the ring, they go. And a clothesline for the left arm right against the throat of Alan Martin. Down he went. James Bradley just standing outside. I'm not so sure he wants to come in or not, because they have really taken the measure of Alan Martin.
Bradley's pretty secure where he's at right now. But Alan Martin, I'm sure, would like to get over and tag Bradley. I don't know if Martin's going to get the opportunity or not. Jimmy Garvin's got Martin up. Shoulder breaker.
This could be it once again. Foot is on the ropes. There you see it right there, left of your screen. Martin close enough to get the foot on the ropes. The only thing it's safe. To the other turnbuckle. Neutral corner now. And Jimmy Garvin continues to pelt away at Alan Martin into this match. Tag team event. And over the ropes. Got the momentum. And both arms right up against the neck of Alan Martin. So Martin trying to get. Did he make a tag? Yes, he did. And now Bradley. He's a big guy, stocky.
About 300 pounds, it looks like. Big James Bradley in there. Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin just kicked him to the canvas.
Really did. And slapped him down once again. So gorgeous Jimmy Garvin taking the measure. Boy, that's vintage Garvin hit right there. There's another one. Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin just flooring Bradley, who had come in with an idea to grab him by the head.
Those granite hands, those tough hands must run in a family.
Yeah, they do.
Ronnie Garvin, the brother of Jimmy Garvin, the man with the hands of stone. We'll see him against Arn Anderson. Michael Hayes chopping away at Big James Bradley.
Oh, he is He is being pelted right up against the corner there. And now Hayes to the top of the head, pounding away. Michael Hayes just looking at his man, who slides right down to the mat. Tommy on the referee. Assigned by the NWA. Now kicking away. Michael Hayes, a warning from Tommy Young. And Precious down there also. The wrong corner for Bradley to be in.
Well, Bradley's finding out what it's like to hunt with the big dogs in there with Hayes and Garvin, because he has not had one offensive maneuver yet. David Crockett will be talking to Michael Hayes and Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin with a very controversial piece of tape that we'll be showing you just a little bit later in this first hour here on the Superstation.
We'll make a comment or two about that tape after we see it. I know that Michael Hayes will have some comments, but it has to do with the situation they're involved in, the Horsemen. And you know the Horsemen are after him. When the Horsemen see that you're a threat to your title, Jim, like they are, they'll do anything they can to take you out.
And that's exactly what they try to do. We'll see that a little bit later in the hour. But right now, Garvin and Hayes have controlled this match. To say they've controlled it from the outset would probably be a gross understatement. They have totally outclassed these two men, and that's not to slack the effort that Martin and Bradley are putting forth. But, you know, you're in there, when they're in there with two of the finest athletes in the National Wrestling Alliance and a great tag team combination.
Bob Brown had him up, kind of a double spine buster right there. Program, Jim Ross.
We're going to take one more look at it here. Michael Hayes and Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin, great teamwork. It was Hayes, the legal man in the ring. He made the tag. Hayes then covered big James Bradley for the 1-2-3.
Okay, we're back. World Championship Wrestling at the St. Louis Arena. What a great first match that we saw between tag team, Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin, Freebird Michael Hayes. But we talked about the Bunkhouse Stampede and the finals of the Bunkhouse Stampede. There's one man who's won more money in the Bunkhouse Stampede than anybody, Jim Ross. This man right here.
Dr. Death Steve Williams has battled his way in the month of December to be the leading money winner. He's going into the finals on January 24th. The cage will surround the ring. It's over the top or through the door, Doctor, for $500,000.
You know something, Jim Ross and Tony? I'm feeling awful good tonight. You know, I've won about five of the Stampede, just like I told the people. Now let's just talk about a little bit of the past. You know, Oklahoma Sooners beat Nebraska. Nebraska shut their mouth off how bad the quarterback is. Now Oklahoma comes back, stomps Nebraska. Now, with Barry Windham and myself and Starrcade, Barry didn't take the advantage. Barry had the chance, but he didn't. Who took the advantage? I did. I'm a champion. I'm the UWF World Heavyweight Champion. I'm touring all over the world. And you know one thing? New York City. New York, New York. What a town. You know something? I'm going up to the big time there, and I'm going to get the money, the big time money. You know, when you see all these faces in here, Dusty Rhodes, Lex Luger, Ric Flair, the Warlord, the Bull Man, when I step in that ring, you'll know who's stepping in there. I'm no stranger to anybody. I'm no stranger to nobody. And when I go up to New York City and when they put the fence around there and shut the gates, people, no one's my friend. No one. Jim Ross, it'll be a night that people can remember, because Dr. Death is pulling out a little few surgeries, you know what I'm saying? It's time to go to the hospital, boys. It's time to get the operation table ready, because Dr. Death is coming to New York City. Hey, look out, boys, because it looks like I'm the winner, Jim. You know what I mean?
I'm not going to debate that point whatsoever. No friends of the Buckhouse Stampedes. I'm sure the other 10 men feel exactly the same way for the $500,000 on the line.
Okay, fans, David Crockett will talk to Freebird Michael Hayes, Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin when we come back.
All right, with us, Freebird Michael Hayes,
the bodacious, precious, and gorgeous Jimmy Garvin.
And David, we're feeling good tonight, I gotta tell you. Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin, Michael P.S. Hayes, and the Squeeze. And there's some things on our mind. Everybody here knows that Michael Hayes and myself have been after Arn Anderson and Tully Blanchard, right? That's right, because we want to be the new World Tag Team Champions. Is that right? That's right. But there's a few things I don't understand, and that is that we had reason enough, didn't we, Michael? We had plenty enough reasons to go beat them, but they give us one more. They were dumb enough to give us one more reason to kick their butts, and we got it on film, and we're going to share it with the people, because if they think they're going to put their hands on our Squeeze and get away with it, they got another thing coming. So take a look at this.
Let's show it to them right now.
Now Garvin. Oh, I thought Garvin may try to suplex him off of there.
Now Jimmy Garvin says, I'm going to take a trip to the top. It wasn't successful for Flair, but it's successful right here for Jimmy Garvin. And a kick count. And Garvin fell right on top of the referee. And I think his knee hit the referee right in the back of the head.
Boy, I think right there, Ric Flair may have seen those diamonds in those limousines. Seeing all those diamonds, all that gold just rushing right away from him on that two count.
And Garvin now. Garvin's got him off the brainbuster. He's brainbusted. The champion of the world.
But the referee's out. Look at Precious.
He's bent down.
One minute. Here comes Tony Blanchard.
Michael,
you know something? You know something? They say that a picture is worth a thousand words. But I'm gonna tell you something. That film right there is worth more than a thousand meanings, Ric Flair. Because I'm gonna tell you something. You call me street trash. You got that right, brother. Because what I am is I am a free bird. I was born one and I'll die one. And this man here, him and I together, we have. Can and will beat Arn and Tully. We know it, and what's worse is you know it. And Flair, you also know we have both had you beat because you understand that you guys are not the same without Lex Luger. You guys cannot, as you so say many times, execute the plan without Lex Luger. You're losing your touch. You're trying to take people out, and you ain't getting it done. Well, I'm gonna make you a promise, Jack. There's gonna be some things getting done. Number one,
Gorgeous Jimmy Garvin, Michael P.S. Hayes, new world tag team champions. Then we're going to take the rest of your gold, Flair. We're going to take yours, and we're going to take your money. I would take your women, but I wouldn't have trash like that. I'm going to take your limousines. I'm going to take your life. And we're going to take more than anything your ego. Because what you did was you done wrote a check that your butt can't cash.
All right, coming up next, you'll see the total package. Lex Luger in action.
Lex Luger, and what an ovation. The young ladies, the young men, our children, men, women, children of all ages standing as this tremendous athlete has made his way to the ring. And she's certainly, that young lady was certainly getting an eyeful. And that's the reaction that we've been seeing, Tony, recently, coast to coast, for this young man who has said that he's going to win his matches on his own athletic ability. And his situation is so physical and so volatile with a four horseman that it's beyond compare.
Let's remind the fans, he is one of the 11 men that'll be in the cage at the Nassau Coliseum, Long Island, on January 24th, trying to win the $500,000 in the Bunkhouse Championship. Luger tosses Keith Steinbrenner away.
Well, it's got to be an intimidating factor. He's not going to hurt anybody posing, but it's so intimidating for another athlete to have to look at that man, at that body, and that intensity, and know that you're going to have to go to hand-to-hand combat with him. And that's what Arn Anderson has said that does not faze him. And Anderson is one man that I really believe that you cannot physically intimidate no matter what.
There's no doubt about that. Being a member of the Four Horsemen is one thing, but being called the enforcer of the Four Horsemen is quite another for Arn Anderson. As they watch on here at St. Louis, Luger continues to pull away and pound away at Keith Steinbrenner. Obviously, Luger came into this match the heavy, heavy favorite, and he is just showing a nationwide audience and the fans here at St. Louis exactly what he is made of.
Luger with the arm bars. 6 feet four, 275 pounds. And the Four Horsemen will certainly have their work cut out for them if they're going to do what they say they're going to do to Lex Luger. Because what Alan Martin is doing, or Keith Steinbrenner is doing, not even facing Luger.
Got him in the corner, and Luger just grabbed him by the chin, slung him to the other side, and now to the ropes he goes. Luger at the elbow. Lex Luger. Showing us all the tools Jimmy talked about. Pride and athletic ability. Here it is! The power slam!
That was a perfectly executed power slam. And this tremendous crowd here at the arena here in St. Louis, they know what's coming. And so does Keith Steinbrenner. It's a human torture rack, and he is reaching his guts here. Luger, tremendous power slam, the 360. Down goes Steinbrenner, and there's the sign. Everybody in the house knew what was coming, and Luger methodically walks back over. He manhandles Keith Steinbrenner. He's got him up on his shoulders right here. It takes a very special athlete to execute this maneuver, and now let's go to Tony Schiavone and the total package.
Okay, Jim Ross, and here he is. The fans congratulating another win. They keep mounting up for Lex Luger. A lot of things on your mind. I know the Bunkhouse Championship, but also the enforcer, Arn Anderson.
You know, Tony Schiavone, 1987 has come and gone. A lot of mistakes were made. Things you can't change. Things you can't talk away. But actions for the total package. Lex Luger will speak louder than words in the year 1988. Emotional scars were caused. But all I can do is say 1988 is a year where I've made a personal commitment to excellence. Excellence that the sport of professional wrestling has never seen. Now I'd be a fool if I could stand out here and say I could take out three guys at once. Well, I can't take them out one at a time. When you're surrounded in hostile waters, I know only one way. You strike out the first thing you see with reckless abandon. And that's you, Arn Anderson. You stepped up front from day one from Starrcade on, saying, what's in my mind? My mind wasn't on wrestling. My mind was in movies, on commercials. Well, when we step in the ring, Arn Anderson, my mind won't be on movies, and it won't be on commercials. It'll be to kick your butt like it's never been kicked before. You can count on that. When you deal with Arn Anderson, you're also dealing with Tully Blanchard. You're also dealing with Ric Flair, who says, I'm the dirtiest player in the game. Well, I've been there. I've been down in the sewer. So if you want to wrestle, I'll wrestle. If you want to fight, I'll fight. And if you want to get dirty, I can get just as dirty because I've been there, brother. And Arn Anderson, you're first on the list. My New Year's resolution is to take the fractured remains of the Four Horsemen and put it to rest. I will be your worst nightmares come true. All three of you, you're going down one by one. 1988 is the year of the total package. Right here, baby.
No denying that, Lex Luger fans. More action when we come back. He's as hated as anybody that ever to step in the squared circle in St. Louis, Missouri. I tried to talk to Murdoch, Tony, before we went on the air today. He said he had a hangover, didn't want to talk to anybody. He said they're listening to Reba McEntire on his Walkman. And he was in a bad mood. And so I feel very sorry for Jason Walker here because Captain Redneck must have went out of town last night and is in a nasty mood here today.
Elbow to the top of the head of Jason Walker, and now Murdoch does not care if you hold on to the ropes or if you want to run away from him down at ringside. He's going to go after you and try to hurt you.
He's a man that has very little scruples. He will do anything for a dollar. That's what he worships, the almighty greenback. And he is one man that has said very clearly that he will defeat Dusty Rhodes for the United States Heavyweight Championship. And really to... not to discount, obviously, Dusty Rhodes' ability as a champion. Dick Murdoch is a veteran. He is tough. He will do anything it takes to win, and he knows Dusty Rhodes very, very well. Former tag team partners. Now, right here, I know where he's coming. Over here. Well, Murdoch.
That's...
what are you going to do? He's amazing.
Yeah, he's a sick individual. There's no doubt about that. Murdoch, now having a few words to the fans here. He is a wild man. Look at Tommy O.
We've knocked over chairs or everything that we had here. I told you he was in a bad mood. Hey, he must have run tied one on last night. At some old honky-tonk somewhere, Murdoch went out.
Do me a favor, don't talk to him anymore before the matches. He must have had something against you because he went right at us.
He don't like anybody from Oklahoma. He don't like anybody anywhere. He's like a rattlesnake. He doesn't get along with anybody.
Here he comes again.
I hope he stays away from here. Murdoch with a right hand. Oh, you can hear that on my microphone. I wish some...
Anderson's walker's biggest problem right now is getting untangled.
I hope my microphone's still working. Murdoch just choked the life out of this young kid with my microphone cord. Well, I'll tell you something. Murdoch, I think, has gone over the edge. He's beating this kid up with a marker. Anything that's not nailed down is just apt to be used as a weapon. Have you ever seen Murdoch any more deranged than we are here? I know he would like to beat Dusty Rhodes. They used to be partners. Rhodes has, both men's careers have skyrocketed, but I don't think Murdoch can say his career would be on a parallel with the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. Perhaps that jealousy over the years has finally pushed Murdoch over the edge because he came out, his eyes were glazed over.
I mean, a madman, and now the fans getting behind Jason Walker, who's trying to get back thing against a deranged man. Oh, he went right to a foot, and that'll stop any rally at all.
Well, one good thing about it, Tony, you'll get to talk to him when this match is over.
I think he's going to go down and talk to David, and I certainly hope he does.
Or whoever.
Let's see if we can't push him that way.
I'll tell you something. This guy has been out in West Texas too long. He's been waiting the snow out there. They got a big snow in West Texas, and Murdoch must have been caught out there with his horses.
Tommy Young was shoved out of the way. No regard for the rules, for the referee, for anything here at ringside. Murdoch, the man, you know, you talked about going after Dusty Rhodes and the U.S. title. He would as soon put Dusty out of wrestling as he would win the title.
I agree with that wholeheartedly. He just, boy, what a, I mean, a vicious forearm blow. Look at this.
I can't stand neither one of you.
Boy, I tell you what, that's a face only a mother can love.
And the fans right on Dick Murdoch, who has come in here against this youngster.
Murdoch's not going to win any beauty contests, but they don't care about beauty in those honky-tonks. I know that because I've seen some of the girls he's been with. Beauty is of no consequence. I'm glad they're on the other side of the ring now. I tell you, this Jason Walker needs a medal. He needs a medal of valor here because Murdoch has beaten the life out of this kid.
And again, elbow stretching the neck across the apron of the ring. That elbow right on target, not only with the impact of that, but the neck being slung back against the apron. Okay, to the other side now. Let's see what Murdoch has in store. That padded elbow one more time. And again, he looks around the building here to the fans. Dirty Dick Murdoch, Captain Redneck, whatever one you want to call him, he still is an awesome force in the sport. There is no denying that because one of his moves, the Brainbuster, let's see if that's what he's got him for.
He set him up there for a long time. Down on his head came Jason Walker, and surely Murdoch will put him out of his misery here. One, two, three. And this great crowd here in St. Louis, as Murdoch gives them the hook on horn sign, they don't like Murdoch in St. Louis or anywhere else in the country. Let's take one more look at it. Murdoch with Jason Walker set up in the Brainbuster position. And he sat him there for a long time and dropped him right on his head. Dick Murdoch with a victory. And now, thank goodness, let's go to David Crockett with Dick Murdoch.
Well, here he is, and I don't have to say much about him. You saw what type of individual he is.
What do you mean here he is? What type of individual is David Crockett? Let me get one thing straight with you. You nothing happening, little melon farmer. I hate this place. I hate this state. I hate this town. I hate this building. And I hate each and every one of these people it's associated with.
They probably
now,
about you.
I don't care, David Crockett.
We can tell.
Because it takes a lot to get Dick Murdoch out of the great state of Texas. And I only really leave that state for big and special occasions. And I've been getting a lot of stuff in the mail lately, David. One of them is a blank check for $50,000 and the condition that I read professional wrestler Dusty Rhodes. Now, it's not going to be an easy job. What do you mean I can't do it?
This is just
how about I start with your little skinny butt?
Sure, you probably could, but you can't do him.
I'll do that for free. Because working for you is like working for the unemployment agency. Now, it's not going to be easy. It's going to be a hard job to get rid of Dusty Rhodes. I know that. But Dusty Rhodes also knows that I'm not going to back up on him, that I'm going to give him all he wants. There's another check for $25,000 to get rid of Ronnie Garvin. That's not going to be an easy chore either. I've known Ronnie Garvin through the years. He's a tough individual, tough competitor. But Ronnie Garvin, I got your number two, buddy, because I can take just a little bit more pain than you can take, and I am just that much better of an athlete and that much better of a wrestler and a whole lot more better of a fighter. Now, there's one job I'm going to do for free, David Crockett, and that's among a lot of things I do for you and your company for free. But Dr. Death, Steve Williams, I'm going to eliminate him just because he played for the University of Oklahoma and just because he thinks he's a big shot in the professional wrestling world. He played at the University of Texas four times. Sure, they beat him once. They played the great Miami Hurricanes twice. They got beat twice. Now, he beat Big Bubba for that World Heavyweight Championship belt, but he ain't beat Dick Murdoch. Dr. Death, I'm taking your belt. Dusty Rhodes, I'm running you. And Ronnie Garvin, your history, bud. Thank you.
Talks cheap. All right, more action to come up right after this.
Here's a man, Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert. He knows Dick Murdoch very, very well. We saw Murdoch not too long ago. We're going to take a look at another rough and rugged individual in the sport of wrestling, Eddie Gilbert.
I think that it's very clear now what many people have thought for years after that last match is over. Dick Murdoch needs counseling. He needs therapy. He's past the line. And this young man here has got one. He's got as much self-confidence in his athletic ability as anybody that'll ever step in the squared circle. Tremendous athlete, great condition, a consummate thinker, always thinking of his game plan. He can't go in, Tony, as we can easily see, and match brute strength with some of the 300-pounders. He has to know how to wrestle. He has to know how to take advantage and capitalize on his opponent's mistakes.
The fans watch on Eddie Hot Stuff Gilbert right on to Atkinson, Steve Atkinson. And he's having some words with the fans here at ringside also. You're right, one of the top athletes in the sport. A man who would love to get his hands on Nikita Koloff and that NWA World Television title, among other great belts. I know he would like a chance at Dusty Rhodes' title. Eddie Gilbert, the type of guy who could slip in there when you least expect it and win a title from you.
He's kind of like Larry Zbyszko in a way. He'll look in the eye and tell you, whatever it takes to win, cheating, lying, stealing, that's what he's going to do. He wants the title that badly. And like you said, Tony, I'm sure he's got his sights set squarely on Nikita Koloff and the World Television Championship. And still to come, speaking of champions, the United States Tag Team Champions, the Midnight Express, we're going to see. Larry Zbyszko and Baby Doll yet to come. Nikita Koloff will be here as well. The two big feature matches, Ron Garvin and Arn Anderson, two of the most physical men in this sport, go one-on-one later in the second hour here on the Superstation. And then the World Six-Man Tag Team Championship on the line. The Road Warriors and Dusty Rhodes take on Ivan Koloff, the Warlord, and the Barbarian.
Now, Gilbert is poised the other side of the ring, and Atkinson coming up. Oh, all the way across, sliding safely into home right on the face.
Gilbert is a very cocky individual. casual. But recently, in a lot of his matches, we have seen him push that cockiness aside and show a very definite mean streak. And that's what we're seeing right here. And Steve Atkinson is certainly seeing it firsthand. He's getting a real kick out of this match, so to speak.
So to speak, it's right now. Gilbert plowing right by Tommy Young to help Atkinson in. Locks him up. Arm over the head. Here comes vertical suplex on the ropes to the center of the ring.
Gilbert took advantage of the weakened condition of Steve Atkinson and took the opportunity to suplex him back in. And as long as he beats the referee's count, can't get disqualified for it, so I guess why not? Oh, stinging right hands right to the job, Atkinson.
These are illegal blows now. Tommy Young warning Eddie Gilbert. Clinch fists right to the face. Snap there to take him to the center of the ring one more time. Eddie Gilbert, look at him. Look at a nationwide audience right to the camera there. Stomping him right on the face. Gilbert, yes, it does hurt, and he's right. And the man who's really hurting, you can see right there, Atkinson. Gilbert measures him up one more time and pounds him right in the nose. Slaps him around now. Oh, fired back Atkinson. Right that time to the back. And now Gilbert in the corner. Atkinson holding on. Gilbert to the other side. Atkinson trying to flip him up. But Gilbert held steady right to the ring.
Gilbert was in control all the way. Gilbert in control all the way, no doubt about it right here. I tell you something, he's another volatile individual. He's like a time bomb. We haven't heard a lot from him lately. That's kind of scary when you stop and think about it.
That's right. Like I said, when you least expect him to, he'll pop up and upset somebody for a title.
Gilbert has excellent strength for a man his size. He's not in the super heavyweight category. He makes up for it in many, many ways. Right off the top rope with that elbow right to the solar plexus. And I tell you, I really believe Tony could cover him right here for the 1-2-3 if he wanted to.
He wants him to get up. Gilbert right here in front of an nationwide audience on the Superstation wanting Atkinson to give it a fight, which he is really trying to do. Now Gilbert got it about. Took him over and down hard to the mat. Gilbert holding him down. Not only a two count. Tommy Young really upset at old Gilbert for those tactics. Pulling the mat up.
As you said, Tony, he's taking the opportunity here on the Superstation. This program being seen nationwide to send a message out to Nikita Koloff and anybody else that cares to listen or to watch that Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert will be a force to be reckoned with.
And now Atkinson firing away one more time. Gilbert to the other side. Atkinson got up high. Ready to get drop kick that time. Gilbert up against. Oh, he was too quick for Atkinson that time. Had all his faculties about him that time. Moved out of the way. And Atkinson, yes, Gilbert is calling for the hot shot. His move. Here it comes. To the other side. Over the top. There it is. Awesome move, Jim Ross. That's going to be about it.
It's a devastating move. Very arrogant cover there, wouldn't you say? And Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert with a victory. Here on the Superstation World Championship Wrestling, we're going to take another look at Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert's patented hot shot. Gilbert sends his opponent for the ride to the ropes. And the key here is the top rope on the far side of the ring. That's what Atkinson meets with all the velocity and force there. He hit it, and then it was merely academic. Hot Stuff Eddie Gilbert with a victory.
We talked about bizarre individuals. Here's one right now, Kevin Sullivan, and he's with David Crockett.
Bizarre he is, Kevin Sullivan.
Well, David, you know, I hear people talking about game plans failing. I hear Dr. Death talking about how he played in big games. And now it looks like someone's playing a game with Dickie Murdoch. They've offered him $50,000, get rid of Dusty Rhodes, and he doesn't know where it is. You see, I like to play games because in the big game of life, there's a wheel. And when you spin the wheel and it goes around and around and around, it says dreams on one side and reality on the other side. You see, people that follow Dusty Rhodes and his dream have played the wrong game. You see, they've talked about what they're going to do. The game I play is reality, and reality is hard. It's cold and it's cruel. The real world is nothing but a hard game. You see, in the Nassau Coliseum, they're playing the biggest game for the biggest amount of money. $500,000 with them all locked into the cage. And everybody's trying to play the biggest game to get all that money. You see, it reminds me, David, one time when I was in Singapore, I went to a game where they played for their life. They locked them into a little cubicle, and they gave them anything they wanted. And the game for them was their life. In this game, eight people played, and only one person walked out. And I'm going to tell you this. I have heard too much talking about what is going to happen. Now the harsh, cruel reality of the world is this. And you can take it to the bank. The game I play is for keeps, because if you look in these eyes, you'll see tombstones written all over them. And there's a lot of blanks to be filled in.
He is bizarre. Coming up next, the Midnight Express with the King of Polyester, Jim Cornette.
Ladies and gentlemen, the United States Tag Team Champions, the Sultans of Swing, Beautiful Bobby and Sweet Stan, the Midnight Express.
Wrestling, Jim Cornette and his Midnight Express, no doubt one of the top tag teams in the world.
And that's it? Isn't that special?
Yeah, that's one of the moments that only...
That's one of the great moments in sports right there. You folks that are taping this program, I'm sure they're going to keep that moment for years to come.
That's probably not all we're going to see. Oh. That was quite an inspiration for Beautiful Bobby, wasn't it?
Who knows? I'll tell you something.
Get your words in faster, Jim. Is he going to come over here?
Oh, probably. We can't be. We're sitting here in this great wrestling city, and I'm sure that Mr. Cornette will join us sometime before this match is over. That's not wishful thinking. It's just the harsh, cold reality of sitting here.
Yeah, he's kind of staying over there, but let's talk about the fact of this team. Beautiful Bobby against this man right here, the Alabama Junior Heavyweight Champion, Mike Jackson, who's quite an athlete himself. Beautiful Bobby throws him up to the top. He jumps over. Beautiful Bobby, he starts the other way. Oh, he caught himself. He caught himself right on the ropes. Beautiful Bobby takes advantage of it.
That's what happens, Jim Ross, when you try to get a little too fancy against the best. Just thought I'd remind you.
Okay, thanks very much. Mike Jackson, a man with two master's degrees, a very intelligent man. He won't make too many mistakes right off the mid by Jackson. Bobby Eaton, the high flying one of the Midnight Express, and Mike Jackson is showing that he can get off the ground as well.
Well, to be successful against the Midnight Express, you got to go right at him. If you wait for him to beat you up, that's exactly what they're going to do. And now Cody Starr comes in. Jackson electrifying this audience right here at the beginning. And now it's Beautiful Bobby. Jackson was out. Starr ducked under. And now comes up with an arm bar. Cornette just shaking his head right here at ringside.
Bobby Eaton, the man that has been earmarked by Jim Cornette to be the man to
take the United States Championship away from the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes, and Sweet Stan, who has his sights set on the World Television Championship, currently held by Nikita Koloff. So Jim Cornette has put a tall order in front of his two great athletes, and these guys are great athletes. Cornette couldn't even spell the word athlete, but that's really irrelevant. He's a strategist. You got to hand him that. His men always come to the ring very well prepared. But Eaton and Lane are great athletes, and they prove it night after night.
Double elbow right up against the chest of Cody Starr. Beautiful Bobby. Now grabbing on the Starr with the front face lock, holding right out. There you see Sweet Stan, and here's the tag. Sweet Stan, since coming to the Midnight Express, certainly has just fit right in a big way, right to the top of the head. And of course, Stan Lane was a great athlete many years prior to becoming a member of the Midnight Express. But right now, the height of his career, no doubt about it.
Well, he was always a great tag team wrestler, but he never, I don't think, really reached his full potential until he came with Jim Cornette and beautiful Bobby Eaton. And Eaton, I think, is in a class by himself in many ways. Many of the offensive maneuvers that he does, he is in a class by himself. And perhaps his style is the style that can put Dusty Rhodes down. It remains to be seen. But moves like this are lethal. This is a lethal weapon right here.
Right off! All of his weight, right down on his rear end, right on top of the guy.
A lot of wrestlers use the leg drop as their finishing maneuver. But nobody uses a leg drop like beautiful Bobby off that top rope. You know, Tony, this city's rich in heritage, it's rich in wrestling tradition, and the man that made St. Louis the wrestling city that it is, one of the founding fathers of the National Wrestling Alliance and the former president of the NWA, the legendary Sam Muchnick, is here tonight, sitting in the front row here at the arena, and we're very, very happy to have Mr. Muchnick here with us, watching the National Wrestling Alliance. And I think that's testimony itself. If Mr. Muchnick's here, you know it's got to be the very best.
You're right, Jim Ross. Well spoken right there. Mike Jackson going right after Sweet Stan. Either way. Jackson can't fight. And he shot Sweet Stan. He bounces off again. He cradles it over. Only got a one count. Stan was up. Give Sweet Stan a lot of credit. He got out of that one in a hurry. And now the tag has been made. A tag has been made.
Starr's got to be in the 275-pound range. But beautiful Bobby with that suplex. And now these are blatant kicks to the head. Tag, another tag has been made. Sweet Stan comes in for the Midnight Express. The reigning United States Tag Team Champions, and an awesome team they are.
There it is. That was a choke maneuver. He grabbed him by the throat, slung him to the mat, and now stretching out Cody Starr doing a circle with him. There you see Bobby. Here's the rocket launcher.
Seen that much lard drug around the ring and it spread out like a pancake? No, you haven't.
Well, you're exactly right. And we've got a win right here for the Midnight Express.
Beautiful Bobby and Sweet Stan.
These guys, just some of the things they do are just beyond description as we take another look at it. In slow motion here, Stan Lane sending the man right into that clothesline, and then he makes the tag. And then we're going to see Eaton didn't even come into the ring, walks right down the apron. Lane sets him just where he wants him. And then you're going to see one of the most devastating maneuvers in wrestling, the Midnight Express Rocket Launcher.
Fans, more action, our second hour right after this timeout.
One of the best teams in the world, the United States Tag Team Champions, the Midnight Express.
Give me your finger. Give me your finger. You feel any sweat right there? Feel it, boys. You feel any sweat? They didn't even work up a sweat. Let me tell you something. It's 1988. We got three New Year's resolutions. One is going to be Nikita Koloff. Every time we get Dusty Rhodes where we want him, he steps in. So Sweet Stan Lane's going to be the new World TV Champion, getting Nikita out of the way. Beautiful Bobby is going to be the new United States Heavyweight Champion. And then, number three, we're going to get Dusty Rhodes out of the way. Dusty, can you imagine that? Dusty Rhodes, and then Nikita Koloff is the friend of a guy who's the son of a plumber. He helps him out.
So in other words, Jimmy, what you're saying to me is we got a son of a plumber and a guy who helps a plumber. That makes him a plumber's helper, right? And we all know what a plumber's helper is, a wooden stick about that long with a big suction cup on the end of it. And every now and then you take it to the reading room and you manipulate it and it pulls the muck out. And that's exactly what you are, Nikita. You're muck. And when I get through with you, I'm going to reach up and pull that chain and flush you back to Russia.
And let me tell you this, Dusty Rhodes, the most important reason, not the fame, not the money, there'd be a lot of that, not the prestige. We want to get rid of you, Dusty Rhodes, because we want to show everybody, regardless of popular opinion, all men are not created equal. Some men were born to be great and powerful, movers and shakers, rich and wealthy. And some people, Dusty Rhodes, were born to be the guy that digs the ditch, the guy that carts the garbage, the guy that always hopes for that big break and never gets it. That's your people, Dusty Rhodes. That's you. For 16 years, you've beaten the odds. You've made the money, you've gone the places and done the things and won the titles that a guy born in a poor dirt farm of Austin, Texas, to a stinking plumber, a guy like that should never have attained fame. You beat the odds for 16 years. But Dusty Rhodes, those odds are catching up with you. These are the odds, because these are the next men that are going to reign where you've reigned. We're going to get rid of you. We're going to take you out. We're going to get the fame, the money, the prestige. But more importantly, we're going to show all the blue-collar working-class trash that has worshipped you for 16 years that they haven't got a chance. They haven't got that one ray of hope. They haven't got that dream after all. The American dream is money, is power, is prestige, and is birthright. The American dream is not a stinking, dirty son of a plumber or a guy that sticks one of those things in those porcelain things. You know what I'm saying? See you later.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's go back to the ring.
Thank you, David. Larry Zbyszko, along with Baby Doll, will go up against Lee Peek, the very beautiful Baby Doll, along with the very capable Larry Zbyszko, who has been making his name in the NWA by leaps and bounds, Jim Ross. No doubt about that.
Well, he's a man that has talked about 13 glorious years in the squared circle. But all through those 13 years, a major championship has eluded this great athlete. He has had a very unique career, Tony, in that he has attained superstar status without ever carrying a major championship. That in itself is a great accomplishment. But Zbyszko, I think at this point in time in his career, feels like that he's right, he's got the experience, he's got the background, he's got the knowledge, and he is right to take the championship, whether it be from Barry Windham, who he's challenged, from Dusty Rhodes, the U.S. title, or perhaps even the Nature Boy, Ric Flair, for the heavyweight championship of the world. I don't think it makes this man any difference. He wants a championship. Whoever's got it, he wants it.
He may, and he is, talking about Barry Windham in the ring as you take a look at Zbyszko, multi-talented.
He talks about Barry Windham all the time. You can go in the dressing room and do a little eavesdropping. He's talking about Barry Windham. You can go into a restaurant and set a table or two away from him. He's talking about Barry Windham. It's like an obsession. He wants Windham's Western States Heritage Championship. And, of course, Barry Windham right now has really got his hands full in a very emotional situation with Dr. S.T. Williams, because they were great friends. I don't think we can say they're great friends now. But be that as it may, with that woman, Baby Doll, and her knowledge, Windham, I think, is on a collision course. And 1988 just might be his year. The 14th glorious year might be the key year. Who knows?
Certainly could. Right now, Zbyszko down on one knee. See if we can hear what he's saying here. He's arguing with Tommy Young, the referee, and now a word to the fans.
Don't forget, ladies and gentlemen, right here on the Superstation, here on World Championship Wrestling, still to come. You're going to see the World Television Champion, Nikita Koloff, in action. We're going to hear from Ric Flair, Tully Blanchard, J.J. Dillon. We're also going to see Ronnie Garvin and Arn Anderson go one-on-one, which has got to be a brutal contest. And then the six-man tag team championship of the world will be on the line later in this hour. Another reason to watch the Superstation and to watch Tony Schiavone this Sunday afternoon for a very special program, our Sunday edition program here on TBS.
Okay, Jim. To the back goes Zbyszko, and now He is really cranking things into high gear. Has him up for the backbreaker. Right down on the side. He covers him. He got a two count. And look how quickly he is up to his feet again. Intensity. Staying on his man. And intimidation. Pointing right at Tommy on the referee. Snapmare takes him over his baby doll. Very calmly watches on from ringside. Although she will get up in that ring and she'll get involved. Barry Windham knows that forte.
Certainly does. And that's the man that Zbyszko would like to have in the ring right now. He's still talking about Barry Windham. It could be Dusty Rhodes, it could be Ric Flair. Whoever's got a championship, a singles title, that's who he's gonna talk about. But he has had some battles. I mean, some real physical confrontations with Barry Windham. Shoulder breaker. He's had some battles and taken advantage of young Kendall Windham on occasion. That chin lock's got the knee there for leverage. Reverse chin lock. Windham isn't here, as you and I know, and he knows that too.
Well, it's awfully easy to talk when the man's not around. But Barry being in the belly was not shut him up, actually.
Well, that's true. That's exactly right. You know,
back to the ring, boy, and he is leveling Lee P. He has so many moves, does Zbyszko, and this is why he is a superstar, been able to attain it without winning the title, because people, observers, promoters realize his talent. A man is just an awesome wrestler, an awesome athlete.
He's one of the finest offensive wrestlers in the sport today. He's also a great defensive wrestler. Very dangerous on the ropes. He's got a martial arts background. He's got that woman at ringside. And we know that she's not there just for moral support. Great neck breaker. That's dynamite there.
And that is his move. And that puts out Lee P. There was Zbyszko. Pops right up again. Larry Zbyszko. No denying that. As he shuts down Lee P.
We'll take one more look at it, and you're going to see one of the most perfectly executed neck breakers in professional wrestling right here. Larry Zbyszko's version is so effective. Perfect. Larry Zbyszko with another victory, and we're going to hear from him in just a few moments.
Nikita Koloff that anyone with a championship is fair game for us.
It's okay.
That's right. We're just giving them all fair warning that they're all stepping. So, and Barry Windham, you're the first one, and we're setting a time limit on you. Barry, watch out, because New York may be their downfall.
You know what? I just hear one of these spud heads say, wait till Barry Windham gets his hands on me. I've been waiting 2 months for Barry Windham to put his hands on me. I don't see him in the ring. I'm calling out his name. There's another one right there. Another Stairway to Heaven victim. Well, Windham, January 24th, Nassau Coliseum, I have you. And I want to give you every opportunity to put your hands on me. Make all these spudheads happy, because they're going to get to see you tie up with a living legend. That's me, too. Okay? That's what I consider myself, too. And Windham, that Western States Heritage Championship is going to Baby Doll and myself. One step on the Stairway to Heaven. There's another one in the ring. Dusty Rhodes, there will be another one. Nothing is going to stop Zbyszko on his Stairway to Heaven, to his destiny. And right here, Dave, right here is the key to it. Right here is the key. Just like Baby Doll's a U.S. Marine, and I'm a Russian spy, you get it? And she gives me all the top secret information on each and every one of you. So, Windham, you blew your chance. Make these people happy. Put your hands on me. The rest of you, your time limit has not run out yet. You hand your belts over to Baby Doll or myself, or you're going to face the same humiliation that's going to haunt Barry Windham for the rest of his life.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, let's go to the ring. The world television champion, Nikita Koloff.
Okay, David, thank you. Nikita Koloff defending his world television belt against the menace. They love Nikita Koloff, and they love the NWA. Was that meant for you?
I don't think so.
There he is, the World Television Champion.
That's the girl that's been looking at you all night, Tony.
Koloff with Tommy Young. We are set to go for this, for the World Television title.
Nikita Koloff looking a hole through Larry Zbyszko. And the Menace taking advantage of the situation here. He might as well be hitting the wall here at the arena in St. Louis. Needs to have a conversation with Larry Zbyszko, because Zbyszko raised the ire of the big Russian, Nikita Koloff. The masked man, he may never be the same when this one's all over. He may remember St. Louis, Missouri for a long time to come.
Now that floor is not like a concrete floor.
Look at the goal!
Well, I think you heard that exchange. Was talking about the floor. This is ice laid down on this floor. The St. Louis Blues play hockey. And this covering over the floor, not that much give in it.
No, it's just like a particle board of some sort. And this, it's rather firm, let's say. And the Menace, he's trying, but
you got to give him credit for that. You got to go after this big guy. If you wait on him, you're going to wait too long. There's the knee. The knee caught the Menace, and the Menace has been decked. Boy, that's an awesome save.
It's going to take a very special athlete on a very special night to beat this man. He is so physical, so intense, and I really think he's got Dusty Rhodes to thank for it. He's got a lot of things on his mind.
He really does.
He's very preoccupied with a lot of things. And the blunt of the blow is the Menace here.
The Menace drops. Koloff, show the signal. You see the fans behind him standing up, waiting on this move. One of the most noted moves in wrestling.
The Russian signal almost took the Menace out of his boots.
Champion Nikita Koloff. We're going to take a look at the Russian sickle one more time, Jim.
He sets him, and here he comes with a sickle full force, and the head of the Menace snaps back, and then it is history. The winner of the match, Nikita Koloff, here on World Championship Wrestling. Mike Rotunda, Kevin Sullivan, beware as well.
Okay, we're here at ringside. The Nature Boy, Ric Flair, James J. Dillon, Tully Blanchard, members of the Four Horsemen.
Hey, come here one time, baby. Come here. Tony Schiavone, this is what the Four Horsemen are all about. Good-looking women, long limousines, jet airplanes, notoriety, and all the money in the world. We are the best this sport has to offer. And in the Nassau Coliseum, Road Warrior Hawk, you, my friend, are going to have to shut your mouth once and for all. Because if you don't beat me, pal, if you don't do what you've told the world you're going to do, then, buddy, the bottom line is you'll be mine all night long. Come on in, guys. Come on, JJ.
Get this, buddy.
Light it up, JJ.
Right there, Rickles, you said it. But you know, I think back earlier in the show, Tony Schiavone, you got Michael Hayes out here talking about it. He's going to take this from us. He's going to take limos. He's going to take me, coach. He's going to take women. He's going to take this, our egos, everything else. Well, Michael Hayes, from the bad side of Atlanta, the dirt people side, you better get inside the ring and start doing some head knocking and a little bit less talking. Because, big boy, until you got one of these strapped around that little bitty waist above those spandex, you got nothing but air, hot air, like all the rest. You're just this much short of what's top of the heap. And what you're going to see, a former champion here get taken down by the other half of the world's tag team champions. And I'm going to sit back and I'm going to enjoy every bit of it. Because, Garvin, what you are is yesterday's news, baby.
You know, Tony, it's great to be here at the arena in St. Louis. Sitting right back here in the first row, Mr. Sam Muchnick, one of the deans of the National Wrestling Alliance. He was the reigning president for many, many years. It's got to be very gratifying for him to come here and see this arena jammed to the rafters. And that's what the NWA and World Championship Wrestling and the Four Horsemen are all about, right, champ?
Come here. Hey, hey, Hawk! Hey, Michael Hayes, I'm talking to you. Would you like to be able to do this? Ah, would you like to be one of Four Horsemen? Would you like to wear a Rolex? Would you like to be cool? This is the Four Horsemen, and that's all you need to know.
All right, let's go to the ring. Well, I'll tell you something. That's it. The Four Horsemen are one of a kind here, as they are wrestling's most elite group, and can't deny that. They're in a class among themselves, and it is great to have Mr. Mustard here at ringside, right here behind our vantage point.
There he is.
Just a legendary man. A man that has meant so much to the National Wrestling Alliance and a great friend to the wrestling fans. And I mean this very sincerely. It's great to have Mr. Muchnick here. And this is the kind of match that Sam Muchnick would love to sign. Two great, well-conditioned athletes. Two men representing the National Wrestling Alliance the only way they can, and that is physical. Man on man. Arn Anderson is double tough. There's no doubt about it. As tough a man that has ever stepped foot in the ring. And what more can we say about toughness than Ronnie Garvin? He's a man with hands of stone, Tony. You've seen him more often than not. He's as physical as his. This should be a great one right here.
They are both intimidating individuals, but they both will not be intimidated this time around. Garvin, former world heavyweight champion Arn Anderson, who now may be concerned that Garvin went right to the head that time. Here they go. They lock up one more time. They are in the corner, right in front of J.J. Dillon. The left hand from Arn Anderson, right on target. And now battering the head of Ronnie Garvin. The reversal. Arn Anderson over the top. Arn looks the other way.
Not a chance. Read his lips. It's not going to put the right hand on me. Well, whether that happens or it doesn't happen, well, we'll find out about that as this match progresses. But don't discount the left hand of Arn Anderson. I have seen that left hand do some very, very serious damage to opponents all over this country. Ronnie Garvin has to be aware of that left hand.
Right now, Arn Anderson, a side headlock, holding on to Ron Garvin, the man with the hands of stone. Yes, that right hand is an awesome weapon, but Ronnie Garvin knows you're going to have to work on Arn Anderson a little bit longer before you can wear him down enough to put him out.
We've seen Arn Anderson in the war games sustain a tremendous amount of punishment and kept right on ticking. He's a man that will be one of 11 finalists. 11 brave men will walk into a cage on Long Island, New York, Sunday night, 7 o'clock, January 24th. One man will walk out. His career may be shortened because of the beating that he may take in the ensuing moments in that match. He's going to walk out with $500,000. That's a lot of money. And a lot of friendships can be fragmented. Careers can be shortened. Trips to the hospital made. be commonplace, but for $500,000, it's going to be a very special night.
Let's go.
Finals of the Buckeye Stampede.
Right now, Anderson holding right on to Ronnie Garvin onto the head. Garvin down on the mat. Has also reminded fans that on Thursday, January 21st, the NWA returns to the Fabulous Forum in Los Angeles. Ric Flair will be on that card. Dusty Rhodes defending his U.S. title. The Road Warriors and many other top stars. That's on January 21st at the Forum. Right now, Garvin and Arn Anderson in the test of strength right here. And it's Arn Anderson slinging Garvin right to the turnbuckle. Snapmare takes him over one more time. Trying to hold him out here, working on that right hand. See, on the right hand, on the lethal weapon of Ronnie Garvin. That's the point of attack for Arn Anderson.
That's a very smart move on Arn Anderson's part. Not only is he physical, he's very intelligent. That's a very smart move. Give J.J. Dillon and the Horsemen credit. Because they come into battle well prepared. They're trying to incapacitate the right hand, as you pointed out, Tony, of Ronnie Garvin. That is Garvin's strongest weapon, his big right hand.
One of his other weapons that Garvin stole. But right now, you can see there's a lot of pressure, a lot of pain on that right hand. J.J. Dillon is, well, for a moment, we didn't see him right there, but we could see him out of the corner of our eye, was crawling up towards the top of the ring. And he's a big weapon for Arn Anderson. There's the trunks taking Ronnie Garvin down. Tommy Young didn't see it, so it is legal, I guess, in some aspects. It's a takedown.
May not be legal, but it was allowed. The referee didn't see it. Anderson was using a ropes all ago. Look at Anderson's face.
Yeah, Ronnie Garvin getting that second win now. Slapped him. Open-handed slap.
J.J. Dillon is pacing very anxiously here at ringside.
It is a ploy of the Horsemen. When time is not on their side, when things are not going well, to make things happen outside of the ring. Slow things down. Tully Blanchard does it. Ric Flair does it. They all do it. You may not like it, but I think it's a good move.
Yeah, it's called dictating the pace.
That's right.
You're going to wrestle their style at their pace. They're going to dictate that. And all the great sports teams, the great sports individuals, they do the same exact thing. Vaughn with a nice reversal. Praise him. He's got it rolled up, and Anderson's got his shoulder up.
Now grabbing down to the leg, Ronnie Garvin, the man, one of only 41 men who have held the NWA World Heavyweight title. Ronnie Garvin, J.J. Dillon is grabbing. He pulled on. You didn't see it on your screen, but we saw it. He pulled on to the ropes that time. And it got the break into the ropes.
Good officiating there by Tommy Young, stepping between the men, creating a clean break.
And it's a dangerous place to be. He's going to get in there one more time, right in front of us, right in the neutral corner. Arn Anderson, he caught him coming away.
With a left hand.
That left hand.
His left hand's like a canned ham. It's a big old fat thing, boy. I'll tell you something. He'll nail you with it. Lateral press, count of two, and Garvin kicks out. Anderson right back to the pinning predicament. Once again, he got the shoulder up. See that right hand tape? Nice bridge there by Ronnie Garvin.
Here we go. Garvin one more time. Jumping up, getting that left arm up. And Arn Anderson with all his power. There's a knee. Arn Anderson up onto the ropes now, Ronnie Garvin. Arn Anderson very strong also. He's going to need all of that power if he's going to go after Lex Luger like he's told everyone he is. Now to the side. Twisting on. You hear the fans shouting Ronnie Garvin's name. And Ronnie Garvin cocking that right arm.
This great crowd here, very partisan Ron Garvin here. And remember Arn Anderson, the man they call the enforcer. He has a perfect complement to his strategy, to his physical abilities. He is the man that has stepped forward and said that he will be the man that will put the perfect, the total package Lex Luger down, and we'll be back with more World Championship Wrestling on the Superstation right after this short timeout.
Can even overcome the emotion, can even overcome a man, a veteran like Ronnie Garvin, who sets out right here, widening the base as Anderson was going to go, no doubt, for the board buster. Garvin elevating, can Anderson get him over in the right hand? Just nail on Anderson. The cover.
Face. Giving it all.
Look at J.J. Dillon's face. J.J. is worried, and rightfully so.
Like he's in prayer now for the classic Ronnie Garvin moves. Rakes down his back, and Arn Anderson had something left also. The knee, a reversal. Ronnie Garvin, here it is, the abdominal stretch on to Arn Anderson. Now, keep in mind that J.J. Dillon is right there at ringside. He's been involved minor parts. There he is. If things start to get hot, you know something's going to happen with him. History has proven that.
It certainly has. The abdominal stretch. Very effective maneuver for Ronnie Garvin at this point in time. And Arn Anderson shows his great strength. And Garvin shows his tremendous quickness. This is a tremendous match. Moving out to the wrestling alliance right here.
The figure four slapped out. J.J. Dillon, loving it, Ricks. There he is. He is in. He rakes Ronnie Garvin across the eyes. We called it. We knew what happened. It did. Once again, from outside, the leader of the Horsemen helps his man in the ring.
How Dillon can do that and look so innocent and so uninvolved is beyond me. It proves without a shadow of a doubt he's one of the most devious, unethical men in the sport. He's very effective. He's very successful. I'm not knocking that. But that brother, he'll take a shortcut on you in a heartbeat.
Arn Garvin locked in, got him all over the vertical suplex. And Dillon is still shaking at ringside. He got Arn Anderson out of that situation. How many more times can he be called upon to do it without getting caught?
J.J. really buried his fingers in Garvin's eyes. And Garvin is still feeling the pain from that. Arn Anderson now is back to his feet. Hammering away with that big left hand. So let's see now if Anderson can regroup and gain some offense here. Turn the momentum, so to speak.
He knocked him upside the head with the left hand. Garvin staggering. Now he's swinging wildly as Anderson was doing earlier on. Anderson connecting each and every time with the left hand. He's got that knuckle popped out. You saw that. And it hit him right on top of the head. Everywhere he can hit him. Every pressure, weak point. Anderson's going to take advantage. Down on the mat they go.
It's
version of the old camel clutch. A move that's been used throughout professional wrestling. You know, you get to thinking at this point in time in this grueling physical matchup that both men are looking for that one knockout punch, the home run, the bomb. And because they traded so many blows, they traded offensive maneuvers. One man's going to make a mistake, or at least I'm sure that's what they're hoping, and the other can take advantage of it. That one home run punch is what they're looking for.
Ronnie Garvin slowly getting to his feet. Arn Anderson can do nothing but let him get up. There he goes, slides in from under him. He's facing him now. The knee one more time. Chooks him out on the floor. He hit very hard. Right on his hip. Right on the floor. Ronnie Garvin did. And he just kind of caromed up against the steel railing. That right hip hit very hard.
Garvin landed right on his face there. Garvin is in a bad, bad way. And this may be the break that I was talking about. This may be the break that Arn Anderson needed to take over on Ronnie Garvin.
He goes to the post. Garvin blocks it. Turnbuckles on Anderson. Ronnie Garvin to the top. Oh, he went to the side body block. Arn Anderson caught him, and he nailed Tommy Young with the feet of Ronnie Garvin. The knockout punch. He's ready for it, but Tommy Young is still down.
Challenger.
and for the Soviet Union, 120 kilos, the Russian bear, Ivan Kulov. Ladies and gentlemen, entertain the manager of the Road Warriors, Precious Paul Ellering. And from Austin, Texas, weighing in at 270 pounds, also the U.S. heavyweight champion, here he is, the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. And a combined weight of 595 pounds from Chicago, Hawk and Animal, the Road Warriors.
Well, Jim Ross, here we go. A lot of big men in that ring.
Oh, I'll tell you something. You're exactly right. This one is going to be tremendous, and where else but right here on the Superstation.
The question of who is the strongest in wrestling. Will it be settled here? No, it will not. January 30th in Greensboro, the bench press competition will happen. And I know a lot of questions may be answered. A lot of money on the line. You're talking about some great athletes, though.
You're talking about a $50,000 bench press challenge, but more than that, you're talking about a lot of pride, and what a move the Barbarian just put on Road Warrior Animal. Great. Boy, this Barbarian is he's an animal.
There is no doubt as Animal rises to his feet. Barbarian missed. Animal has him.
And he dropped Dixon.
It's almost many ways. Look at him. It's like an old Mexican standoff. Like a stalemate. No one. Look at Paul Ellering and Paul Jones. No one. It's really a fine line of who is the strongest.
Probably the biggest man as far as body weight's concerned in the ring is the Warlord. We will find out on January 30th if he is the strongest man in the ring, as you said, Tony. Won the big $50,000 bench press challenge. Now, Dusty Rhodes don't claim to be the strongest, and he don't claim to be the prettiest, but he does claim to be the baddest, the bull of the woods, I think he said, if you will.
Well, he's one of the toughest fans all around the world know that. Rhodes drops down quickly. Oh, the elbow! That bionic elbow. Right on the top of the head of a great veteran himself, and Ivan Kulov. And now Rhodes working right on the legs. That's a position, if you're Ivan Kulov, you don't want to be in.
No doubt about it. Well, that'll put your voice up another octave or two if that one's fully executed.
Ivan Kulov in the wrong corner. He's got a Road Warrior on each side. He's got Paul Ellering right in front of him. And he is really trapped. Look at him. Nowhere to go. Right to Animal with the elbow. Now to Hawk, who shoves him back to the ring. That was the safest place for Ivan Kulov to be right there.
And he right back into the hands of the United States champion, the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes.
Here he is. The flip-flop fly sets him down again. Dusty with the arm, tagging Animal. And the big man in again. The boot to the midsection. Animal now, one of the 11 men, Dusty Rhodes also. As a matter of fact, will be in the Buckhouse Championship. One man, that man on your left, Road Warrior Hawk, will go after Ric Flair's World Heavyweight title.
That's all at Nassau Coliseum, Sunday, January 24th, 7 o'clock. What a shoulder block! What velocity from the Hawk on the Russian Bear, but the veteran moved out of the way. And he tags in well over 300 pounds. A man that has easily bench pressed 500 pounds plus, the Warlord. You know, we're talking about the Bunkhouse Stampede. Nice, boy, that's that tackle. There's like two big Mack trucks there.
Side headlock.
Paul Jones says his men are the strongest, and this is a great indication of how strong they are. Great move by the Road Warriors. What teamwork!
And once again, a standoff. We have to take a break. six-man tag team title. The heat is on. Dusty Rhodes, the Road Warriors, the six-man champions of the world against Ivan Koloff, the Warlord, and the Barbarian. And we talked about stalemates and no one being able to get a decisive advantage so far. That has been the case.
What a matchup we've got here, this Barbarian. Jones with all three of his men in the Bunkhouse Stampede. That's quite an accomplishment for Paul Jones. But even a bigger accomplishment would be to walk out of here from the arena here in St. Louis with the six-man tag team championship. That's what that man wants. The $50,000 on the line in Greensboro on January the 30th. But the big prize, the six-man world tag team championship, is on the line right here. And you're seeing it exclusively here on the Superstation TBS. Bear hug by the Warlord. Boy, he is a big, monstrous man. Well over 6 feet tall, about 325, 330 pounds. And the pain etched across the face of the veteran from Austin, Texas, Dusty Rhodes, the American Dream. We're going to stay in this match as long as we possibly can, fans. What a tremendous situation this is.
Warlord cinching up tight. Dusty Rhodes, one more time, three, and he's loose, and he's close enough to make the tag, Road Warrior Animal. Right hand to the back of the head on the Warlord, going right after two big bulls right here, face to face.
Well, they are, that's registered stock out there, two big bulls. And that was a tag made. The referee did not see the tag, and I don't think Tommy Young's going all out. There was a tag made, but to the referee's defense, he did not see it.
Great move by Rhodes, showing some quickness.
Referee saw that tag, the hawk coming in. Oh, man. That'll take some of the power away from those clubbing blows.
Trying to go right at the arms. And the Warlord with some great upper body strength. You take an arm away from him, and that really cuts him in half. We are really down to the bare seconds remaining in the show, Jim Ross. It's been another great 2 hours here on the Superstation. Don't forget to join us tomorrow night for the Sunday edition program, and then, of course, next week. And here, the power slam from the Barbarian.
Well, we have seen some power moves by Jones's trio, by the Road Warriors, and I don't think either team has got a clear-cut advantage as far as this power situation is concerned. What a battle we've got here, Tony. This has been two of the most exciting hours we've ever had here on TBS.
Right hand to Hawk, levels the Barbarian fan. For Jim Ross, David Crockett, I'm Tony Schiavone. See you next week.